So this morning we're going to have Mark Hanna from Iowa State, who's an extension machinery person, is going to talk to us about managing machinery costs and field operations. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Mark.
Thanks a lot, Scott. I appreciate the opportunity, and I'll see if I can pull up the slides here. Okay, it looks like we're ready to go. But again, appreciate the opportunity. And as Scott said, I'm an extension ag engineer over at Iowa State University. So I mentioned that actually for a couple of reasons, but not the least of which is when you hear some of my comments, you might go, our company's not a little heavier on small grain production or maybe something more on forages. And we do have a little bit on forages kind of in here, but that's probably partly where I come from. So you probably need to recognize that a little bit. But see several people I know in the audience today and several people I don't. So I look forward to spending a little time with you here this morning on this. Again, there's handouts available, notes on these slides, and basically kind of a set of the slides there. Let's start right out. Grain farmers, particularly cash grain farmers, have been really tickled pink again here the last few months as grain prices have gone up. And this is just happens to be a shot of monthly average corn price in the state of Iowa over about a 10-year period. And you see those sales are looking good for the cash grain folks. Here that way. Same thing on the soybean side of things. You note on both these slides there's a fair bit of fluctuation over time, and that makes the business a little bit more risky and hazardous that way. But that's kind of the background we're in here at the moment through our Midwestern grain production here that way. It's made a little tougher on the livestock producers. Particularly, I know there's been some real issues on the dairy side of things, but in general, the grain folks are feeling kind of good at the moment. On the other hand, we've got some crop inputs, and one of these is energy use. And this is just a pie chart that I use with data from the state of Iowa from the last ag census, but it breaks out basically the proportion in not BTUs, but in dollars spent between diesel and gasoline, propane, electricity, natural gas, that type of thing. And I use this just to give people an idea sort of where those dollars are going. You know, the last time you paid that electric bill, you might feel like, boy, that's where it's all going, or propane bill the same way if you got a big grain drying year. But in fact, at least in our state, and I think in many of the surrounding states, if you look at the dollar value, why that diesel slice is fairly significant. And so I sometimes do that just to get people thinking about energy use in field operations as we talk. We're all tickled about the sales prices, but some of those input prices, unfortunately, those commodities follow the same trend. And this is a monthly diesel price. Again, this is for the state of Iowa, but I think you would see something similar basically in surrounding states or through the north central region. And hard to keep these updated, but these curves are back on the upside here. So although our sales are going up, our input costs are going up there too. And let's take a quick look at gasoline prices too. Now gasoline is not certainly as big a slice of the pie for farm energy use outside of maybe the pickup truck operation and some smaller engines, but same type of thing happens. And I think you'll find that although energy prices may not be a large percentage price or cost of crop inputs, it can be the input that's almost or most easily controlled out there, and that's what we're going to go through today, take a look at some stuff. Just to get familiar with how much energy we're using out there for field operations, this might be a pretty typical set of operations, again, for a row crop type situation. Maybe using a subsoil or a ripper for primary tillage, one secondary tillage pass with a field cultivator, get the seed in the ground, spray perhaps a couple of times. We've got to get the crop out of the field. This all adds up to around 4.5 gallons per acre. This is a little surprising for some folks that haven't been into it, but on a it turns out that field operations are somewhat consistent on a per acre basis, and even though you're using larger implements, you're getting over the ground faster that way. And so on a per acre basis, there are some rules of thumb, if you will, absent some good on-farm records that could certainly trump this data. But 4 to 6 gallons per acre would be pretty typical for people that are doing some tillage operations that way. Let's kind of contrast that with some other things. I know there's a grain drying webinar coming up here later in the series, I think with Ken Hillevang from North Dakota State, but I just took a look at maybe the per acre cost of corn drying, and I assumed a 175 bushel per acre yield there, a reasonable yield. And I removed 5 points of moisture from that crop. Now, it depends a little bit on whether you're using a high-temperature drying system or low-temperature, but for that high-temperature drying system, why the energy is going to be predominantly propane, somewhere around 15, 16 gallons maybe for drying that 175 bushels and a few kilowatt hours of electricity. If we put that on an equivalent diesel basis, that's around 10 or 11 gallons of equivalent energy in diesel fuel that way. So if you're using a low temperature dryer, actually the energy costs are electric that way, many more kilowatt hours, but in a total energy equivalent, it actually drops a little bit to 7 gallons. Don't write these numbers down for gospel necessarily, but gives you an idea. In years where drying corn is significant, why it can be actually a greater energy component even than those field operations. Of course, not every year is that way, and other crops, soybeans, wheat, that type of thing would not be in that situation. Okay, this is where we're headed here the next few minutes, and we're going to take a look at several different items and kind of focus in for 4 or 5 slides on each of these and on some ways to save energy. And I'll also try and sum up with some potential what this might mean in dollar terms, cost savings that way, examples that way, so you can read down through the list there, but that's kind of where we're headed. In terms of limiting field operations, I tell people, particularly that corn, grain, and soybean production here, you've got to get the seed in the ground, you've got to get the crop out of the field, you've got to harvest, and so in effect you're really locked into this probably about 2 to 2.5 gallons of fuel per acre that way. Even the no-till folks are kind of locked into that. But over on the right side of the graph, you can see for either the primary tillage operations or the secondary tillage operations, why we can also add another gallon, a gallon and a half per acre for a primary tillage operation, depending on what that is. Usually on the high side of a half gallon per acre, 6 or 7 tenths of a gallon per acre for secondary tillage. And so, you know, one primary, a couple of secondary tillage operations, and there's about another 2.5 gallons per acre. And so I'm not saying don't do those operations, but you want to make sure you're getting a bang out of the buck for those. And that's really one of the fastest ways to save energy. If you leave that equipment parked, why that's energy saved right there. Again, it's a management issue for a lot of folks. And speaking of management issue, one thing, at least in our state, for folks that say, gee, I don't know, I'm no-till, I'm not sure that I'm ready for that. And one way of maybe kind of getting in the door here, this is just some 5-year soybean yield averages with different tillage systems at about a half a dozen different research and demonstration farms around our state. And you see that, over a period of time, we just don't see much response of soybeans to tillage. And so for those people that are doing a fair bit of tillage ahead of soybean planting, they may want to rethink that or look at some alternatives, because at least from a yield penalty standpoint, it doesn't seem to be there in this data. Now, I didn't go through and look at lots of other states' data, but I do see similar data often from other states as I go to conferences and meetings. So again, you'll want to kind of pick and choose a little bit to move people kind of in the right direction here, maybe on reduced tillage operations. If you are going to till the soil, and in many cases there is a good reason to do that, once you get beyond that first 3 or 4 inches, there's a certain amount of energy that you expend just doing that, but then your actual energy use or fuel use gets to be pretty closely related to tillage operational depth. This was some interesting work done a number of years ago, actually by some of Scott's colleagues up at the University of Wisconsin. This was Dr. Kevin Schinner's, but he was subsoiling at different depths, and you see here at a 9-inch depth, you're using somewhere around 1 3/4 of a gallon fuel per acre. And when you double that depth up to 18 inches, you almost double the amount of fuel use, up to 3 gallons of fuel per acre there that way. And it's a pretty strong linear relationship there. Again, if you just go 50% deeper with that subsoiler, well, you're going to use about 50% more fuel that way. So again, some serious considerations should be given in terms of if you're going to till, how deep do you need to till? Often that's a soil loosening operation. Is there a compacted layer down there? If so, how deep? That type of thing to take a look at. So what are some of the dollar savings potential here? And I've got several slides coming at the end of some of these segments like this, but I've just used an example over 1,000 acres. But let's say you eliminate one primary or two secondary tillage operations for a gallon and a half of fuel per acre. That over 1,000 acres at today's fuel prices, that equates to about $6,000. Maybe you can't quite do that, but perhaps you can either raise up that subsoiler depth from 15 to 9 inches or maybe eliminate one of those secondary tillage passes, and there you can save about $3,000 over 1,000 acres. So that's the kind of dollars that are at stake here. I'm using $4 a gallon diesel here at the moment. Of course, these numbers will slide up and down with that. Okay, let's take a little different topic here. Ballasting and weighting tractors and slippage out there in the field. I think most tractor operators realize that ballasting is important, but once you get beyond that, the exact way to ballast the tractor seems to be somewhat of a mystery often for a lot of tractor operators. And the first place to look probably is in that tractor owner-operator manual that way, but suffice it to say that there are some rough rules of thumb, how much weight a tractor should be carrying for a certain amount of drawbar horsepower it's trying to develop, as well as what that weight split ought to be between the front and the rear axles. We see some cast iron weights here on a rear axle, but that's important too in terms of getting the weight over the powered wheels. And we don't have time to go in depth on that at the moment this morning, but there are resources out there. Again, tractor operators' manuals and fact sheets. Several state extension services have that. I know we have one here in Iowa, too. A quick check for folks in terms of if you got the right amount of ballast on there often is looking at what's the wheel slip out there that way. And for newer, higher horsepower tractors that are often used for some of the tillage operations out there, there's often a wheel slip meter that's available in the cab of the tractor on the dashboard there, and this can be a good quick check. Turns out that on firm, untilled soil, we get our peak tractive efficiency, and this also is our best fuel efficiency, maximum transfer of power from the engine to the drawbar here, somewhere around 6 to maybe 12 or 13%, say around 10% wheel slip. On untilled soil, on tilled soil, once we've got that tilled up, the actual peak shifts a little bit, and it probably shifts to more like 8 or 9% up to about 15% or so that way on tilled soil. But as a rough rule of thumb, again, on untilled soil, about 10% wheel slip, tilled soil a little bit more than that. That's where we look. I think we can all relate to if a wheel slip gets excessive, we see certainly lower tractive efficiency here as those wheels spin. But also look what happens if we carry too much weight on the tractor and get too low a wheel slip. We're really digging a hole and trying to climb out of it all the time. So that can be just as difficult too. That's the importance of checking into this and knowing what needs to be done. In addition to tractor ballasting, inflation pressure on those tires is important. We see a front wheel assist with duals on the rear axle on this tractor. You know, if you get those tires, we've often heard, make sure that you've got those tires plenty well inflated, and particularly for over the road travel, when you think about using your pickup truck going down a hard surface road, you want to make sure that you've got it inflated up to a certain level. But for off-road travel, there's actually a correct inflation pressure, and it's typically, you don't want to be too high. If you get those rear tires on this tractor overinflated, they tend to ride up on the center line of the tire. You get excess wear there, more wheel slip. There's some issues. There was an interesting study done by some colleagues over at Ohio State where they did a case study with five different tractor operator owners, and this just these different tractor models on the horizontal axis here happen to be different. They happen to all be John Deere tractor models at the time, but they did fall tillage work with tire air pressure in these tractors, either at 24 or 14 psi. And you see, as you compare those bars there, virtually every time when they went from 24 psi overinflated condition down to a more correct 14 psi, they saved in the neighborhood of 5 to 10% fuel use during fall tillage. And actually, this 4955 over on this side, it was a front wheel assist tractor, but you could see the correct inflation pressure for those tires was probably lower than 14 psi because they were saving quite a bit of fuel versus that 14 psi there. So again, knowing what that is, checking that operator's manual and paying attention, that can be important. Now, again, why does this happen? We took a sheet of poster paper and put under a rear tractor tire and inflated the tractor tire to a certain level, and then we took a can of black spray paint, just painted around the silhouette of the tire so you could see the footprint. On the left side here, this particular footprint was with the tire inflated to 28 psi. And we let the same load on the tire, but we let the air out of the tire down to 8 psi. And you see how much longer that radial tire footprint gets and how many more lugs are exposed there for better traction. And so this is kind of the key here. Again, you don't want to get too low at inflation pressure there for wear on tire sidewalls, but know what weight's on that axle, check it out, and use that correct inflation pressure. Use a good tire gauge out there. Just a word or two on precision ag, and I'm not sure, I think you may hear a little bit more about this coming up in the series yet, but some of our newer precision ag tools can certainly help out. This is just a shot of an RTK base station out in the field here, but something to help you line that up and avoid excessive overlap out there. Now I know I'm digging into your pocket a little bit more in terms of it's not just a management issue, but as you trade equipment, as you move up in equipment, this actually can help you energy-wise. This is just a wheel angle sensor on the front axle or tractor here, but auto steer systems, I think the best of us think that overlap, we don't have any overlap, but in fact there is a little bit out there, and prices keep coming down on this equipment, and so there's certainly some potential there as we think about some of the precision ag tools and things like auto swath that are going on, that type of thing. I'll leave that for another day here. But what are the savings potential on ballasting? And again, kind of looking through this, if you really haven't paid attention to that tire inflation or what the weight carried by the tractor, 10% fuel savings is pretty easily reachable here. And again, over 1,000 acres, again, I'm thinking a row crop operation here, but but savings amount to somewhere around $2,000. These are on an annual basis here, over 1,000 acres. Let's say that you do know what that ballast situation is, but just paying attention to that, checking that slip meter occasionally, checking wheel slip, and in particular, get yourself a good tire inflation pressure gauge and check that. Make sure you're within a couple of PSI what that correct inflation pressure is. That can save probably somewhere in the neighborhood of 3% fuel savings. And again, that's about $600 at today's prices. And of course, there's additional labor out in the field, depreciation on equipment that adds up here also. Okay, I'm going to move into a little bit different area here, and we're going to talk a little bit about energy costs for fertilizer. Now, you don't pay energy costs directly for fertilizer, but it can be a significant component. And this slide here, the important thing I want to take a look at is this is actually the amount of energy it takes to manufacture these different types of fertilizer, and you see four different types of nitrogen fertilizer here. Actually, this last one is an older anhydrous ammonia plant versus a newer plant up here. Then energy to manufacture potash, and then our phosphate fertilizers here. And I put this in equivalent, the energy in equivalent gallons of diesel fuel, so we could kind of compare this with some of our field operations here. This is on a per pound basis for pound of nitrogen, phosphate, or potash. The important thing I want you to take a look at here is just as you look at these numbers, these nitrogen numbers are all about 10 to maybe 15 times as high for energy to produce this fertilizer as the potash number down here. As a matter of fact, the phosphate, interestingly enough, it gives up a little energy as you manufacture that. Now, I'm not here to claim that that's all usable, but the important thing with this slide is when we're talking about energy use in fertilizer, nitrogen is really the so-called 800-pound gorilla in the room here. It's the one that predominates in terms of the energy use out there. What's this mean? This is a little obtuse or abstract here, but let's take a look at using, I've used anhydrous ammonia fertilizer figures here, and I've looked at both maybe a rotated version of corn after soybeans here, or this would be a corn after corn, perhaps, application rate. And you see that the equivalent energy amounts here are, we're talking about maybe 5 or 6 gallons for field operations, a few more than that for drying. And it can be quite great for nitrogen fertilizer in terms of energy costs. A lot of that nitrogen fertilizer energy, natural gas used in the Haber-Bosch process, and they've got some improved efficiencies as we saw in that last slide there, but it's still, you want to pay attention to kind of what's going on out there that way. This is just a slide showing corn yield response over here on the left side of the graph versus nitrogen application rate, and this was by a couple of my colleagues here at Iowa State, and again, I would refer you to your own state for this, but I think you would see similarities here. This takes a look at corn yield response for, first of all, corn after soybeans in this curve that way, and you see kind of where this curve starts to flatten out, probably where that maximum economic yield response is, and this would be corn after corn, and of course it doesn't flatten out until a little later spot there. Now, recommending fertilizer rates is way above my pay grade as an ag engineer, so I'm not going to get into that, but just make sure you use the appropriate tool out there and make intelligent decisions from an energy basis. One thing we have gotten into a little bit here at Iowa State is looking at distribution of nitrogen fertilizer, particularly anhydrous ammonia. It's always a problem. And we've looked at different manifolds that are beyond kind of the old open chamber type. This happens to be a shot of the vertical dam manifold that's used on some anhydrous ammonia applicators. And then we actually worked on and help with development of this Pelican applicator here that is also on the market. But either one of these basically give you a better distribution, more even distribution, than what you see with the old open chamber manifold. And just to give you an idea, let's take a look at kind of what I'm talking about here. Again, I'm an engineer. I got to show graphs here, I guess. But this would be outlet ports along the manifold that are feeding 11 different knives along an anhydrous ammonia applicator. And this would be the nitrogen application rate that's coming out those knives. And we basically set this up for an average 150-pound application rate. So, you know, we'd really love to see all these data points lying right along that 150-pound line. But as you can see, neither one of these manifolds do that. There's more scatter than one might like. But actually, we didn't have the old open chamber conventional manifold in this particular test, but that we would see even more scatter with those. But interesting point here is a lot of people put on nitrogen to make sure that they've got adequate nitrogen for all the plants out there. Now, this would be a corn application, but you'd see the same thing at a lower rate scale on wheat. But this even the red dots here for this Impelicone system, you see the lowest application here would be probably around 125 pounds per acre versus the lowest application on the vertical diamond around 107 pounds. If you take even this improved Impelicone and let's say we cut that application rate back 5%, this would be the way that application would stand then. And you see, still even at that point, we've got the lowest application rate here on outlet port number one, still at least as high or higher as the lowest application rate here. And so this is what better distribution can do for you in terms of giving you a little more confidence of what you're doing out there. So this equipment can pay off pretty quickly. Let's take a look at again, some of the economics here. Again, I'm not here to say what that nitrogen application rate ought to be, but let's say that one does a little pencil pushing and a little closer figuring here. I've used a $600 a ton figure for anhydrous ammonia application, and I won't read through all the math here, but on a 1,000-acre basis, if you feel like you can cut back 10 pounds of nitrogen per acre there, it's about $3,500 to $4,000 an acre decision out there. And an energy standpoint, about 1,200 gallons equivalent of diesel fuel. So it can be significant out there. Again, make sure you use an appropriate amount. I'm not saying just cut nitrogen rates out there by any means, but do a little studying, decide what's appropriate. And again, here on our Extension Agronomy website, there's a calculator that several states contribute to, I know, in terms of looking at formulas for maximum economic return to nitrogen. And I would refer you to your own state fertility specialists. Now, okay, I'm going to digress here just for a moment. And this is a dual spinner on the back of a dry spinner fertilizer applicator. And I know when I scan down the attendee list, I know I've got some good gearhead colleagues out there. So I'm going to pause for a minute. There's something wrong with this picture here. And let's think about this a little bit. Turns out that these spinner spreaders, for those of you that aren't familiar with them, these spinners, basically the point that's right here between the two spinners, those spinners are spinning out toward us in the picture. In other words, they're flying out this way, and on this side they're moving around this way, and on the right side they're moving around this way. You put fertilizer granules in this spreader and you try to spread them with the veins positioned this way, they don't go very far. As a matter of fact, you basically just pretty much leave it in a windrow right behind the machine with virtually no spreading. There was a mistake made when the veins went on the machine. The veins in the left spinner need to go on the right spinner and vice versa. You might think, oh, wow, you know, somebody should have caught that. But I'm only using this slide as just a reminder to make sure your equipment is set up appropriately, because this was just a waste of fuel. It was a waste of time. It was a waste of fertilizer money. We can make the same points about the sprayer operation out there that's coming up right now, you know, calibrating and fine-tuning that sprayer. Planter operation, if you didn't have that planter set up correctly and looked at some of the adjustments on that, there's a whole other lecture on that, certainly, that way. That can be some of the biggest wastes of fuel in terms of just having to go back over the field again. And so make sure you do, you know, take your time, make sure you do the job right the first time. probably good advice for all of us, including myself, but there's another fuel-saving strategy. Okay, now I want to shift over into the maintenance area here a little bit, and I think we all realize that maintaining the engines out there, you know, whether it's on the tractor or combine or pickup truck or automobile, that's all important, but, you know, what are the economics there? You know, how does that actually save fuel? First point and most important point to take home here is to follow those manufacturer recommendations, because they have spent a little time in terms of the trade-offs for filter replacement there, and make sure you're scrupulous on those filter and fluid changes. There was an interesting study done by colleagues at the University of Missouri a number of years ago where they had field days around the state, and people were encouraged to bring in their tractors to field days, and they hooked them onto a PTO dynamometer. Turned out that they had, across all those field days, they had 99 tractors, just under 100 tractors there. They tested the tractor as is on the PTO dynamometer, and then they changed both air and fuel filters on the tractor. Didn't make any other adjustments, but just changed the filters and hooked the tractor back up to the PTO dynamometer. And lo and behold, power increased by 3.5%, 3 to 4% average across those 99 tractors out there. You might say, wow, I get a little more power out of here, but the real fuel saving standpoint is you can cut back on that engine throttle operation by about an equivalent amount, about 3 to 4%, and still get the same power that you were getting out of that tractor before you changed filters. And so, again, the engineers in charge of the study estimated fuel savings at around 105 gallons per year per tractor. We're using a little larger tractors this day and age, so those fuel savings would be at least that, and probably closer to 125 gallons or something like that. So be scrupulous on those filter changes out there. Here's an air filter being changed on a tractor, you know, as those things start to clog up with particulate matter, you're actually starting to starve that engine cylinder for oxygen, and you get too rich a fuel burn in there, and there can be issues. And so I know they don't give those filters away. You know, larger modern tractors, a lot of times we're talking probably closer to $100 on some of those filters or more. But on large tractors, it's a money-saving opportunity to stay scrupulous on them. Okay, how about cold weather operation? And I know we're at the time of the webinar here, we're headed back out of that. But, you know, for folks that are clearing snow during the winter or doing livestock chores, you know, a lot of times they'll be using a block heater out there on the tractor. And this is just taking a look at some quick savings out here. But I've just used an example of a 1,000-watt engine block heater here, and I'm using 10 cents a kilowatt hour just for quick, easy figuring. But so that heater's using about 10 cents an hour, and overnight, maybe 12 hours overnight, about $1.20. Alternatively, instead of leaving that plugged in overnight, if we put that block heater on a timer and just heat maybe for a couple hours before we want to start that engine the next morning, we can save, you know, in the neighborhood of $1 a day, or if you're doing this kind of every day through the cold weather season, like $100 is savings out there. And so again, it's, you know, a lot of these are kind of low-hanging fruit. That timer cost will pay back pretty fast here that way. How about idling tractors? I think most of us heard from Dad probably that, you know, you've been working that diesel engine pretty hard out there. You want to make sure you give her a chance to cool down, and we certainly want to be protective of that. But you want to check that tractor owner-operator's manual, because often those idle times have been reduced somewhat over the last number of years. And new tractors now, you look at the operator's manual, a lot of times they're talking about maybe 2 to 4 minutes of idle time, perhaps even a little less. So, again, and that's after heavy use. But I just took an example of a 200-horsepower tractor from Tractor Tests. Just at idle, it's burning about 3 2/3 gallons of fuel per hour. If you idle that tractor an extra 10 minutes beyond the point where you had to, there's about 0.6 gallon of fuel, or about $2.40, $2.50 at $4 a gallon. And you do that 50 times during the year, maybe once a week, or maybe more often in the spring and fall of the year, maybe with some tillage work or that type of deal. But these savings can mount up again, you know, somewhere around $125 a year for 50 long idles a year. Again, you want to make sure that you idle appropriately, but manage that a little bit. And again, maybe you've been working fairly hard in the field under pretty full load, then you got some road transport or travel. You know, by the time you get back to your destination, that tractor engine, maybe, you know, you've been operating at quite a bit lighter load, and so you probably don't have to go through that downtime idle. So what are the potential savings for tractor use, maintenance potential out there? And you can see my assumptions there. I won't go through this too much, but again, somewhere in the neighborhood, these add up to about $500-$600. Again, you know, depending on options and what you're after. And a lot of times, you know, except for maybe getting a timer on that block heater, we're not talking anything new or different here. You're going to change the filters on that tractor anyway, but you can kid yourself into false efficiency if you try to stretch that maintenance time at all that way, particularly with fuel prices where we are. Okay, next topic, and shifting gears a little bit, and pun intended for those of you that are listening closely here, but for a lot of tractor operations, you know, we have a certain fleet of tractors out there, and they're not always just evenly matched to the task at hand. And you think about a row crop operation, we're headed into a time where we've got a classic example here, maybe with post-emergent spraying coming up. This tractor is not heavily loaded through the drawbar pole with this sprayer here, and as long as we're not using a PTO drive or something where we need that extra tractor engine efficiency, we can make use of actually pulling back on the throttle and shifting up to a little higher gear for these loads. This is particularly appropriate for, you know, smaller tillage implements, maybe a planter that doesn't require as much drawbar poles, what we've got available on the tractor, certainly sprayer operations, things like that. You can find out what that savings potential is actually out of a Nebraska tractor test, and that's what I've done here. This is actually data from a tractor test for, this happens to be a Case IH Magnum 245 tractor. And this particular tractor develops a maximum drawbar horsepower of just under 175 horsepower, 173 horsepower. Turns out if we use it develops that maximum drawbar horsepower at seventh gear. That way, that's where we find our maximum efficiency to get the greatest horsepower out of this tractor. If we operate this Case 245 tractor at more like a three-quarters load, say this 138 horsepower figure, if we continue to leave that transmission in seventh gear there, we're using actually about an extra gallon per hour of fuel beyond what we would use if we shifted up a couple of gears to ninth gear on this tractor. So about a 10% fuel savings. You see over here at 50% load, that 95 horsepower load here, fuel savings are even greater, and there's about a 2 gallon fuel savings here as we shift up a couple of gears to ninth gear here, and it equates to about a 20% fuel savings. Now, every tractor is going to be a little different here. Newer tractors have gotten a little more efficient at this as I look at the data, but some summary data over a 20-year period, this 10 and 20% fuel savings would be fairly typical of what you would see out there that's available. Again, I think a number of tractor operators do know they can cut back on that fuel some, but the issue here is kind of push yourself a little bit. You certainly don't want to lug the tractor out there or overpower it, but a lot of times, you know, shifting up to a little higher gear, you know, easing back on that throttle, it's just a direct fuel savings, direct management. Newer tractors, by the way, actually have that, some newer tractors have that as an option, sort of on automatic control systems or sort of cruise type control in the tractor, again, kind of another issue, but detailed in other places. If you're using a power takeoff operation like this, pull behind forage harvester here, this type of shift up throttle strategy is not appropriate here, because you're going to have to keep that engine speed up to keep the power takeoff shaft up at a certain speed to operate the load. And so for this, or perhaps some nerve spreading operations, maybe mowing, baling, that type of thing, why you don't really have that option. But for drawbar work, and a lot of tractor work ends up being drawbar work, that can be something that's happening. Okay, again, over 1,000-acre operation. I've assumed a couple of lighter passes, maybe closer to the end of the season, either that planter or sprayer, maybe a smaller tillage implement. 15% fuel savings is probably typical and could be more, particularly that sprayer that we saw in the picture there. But if we're going to use about 1.3 gallon per acre over those two operations, saving 15%, there's about 0.2 of a gallon per acre. Over 1,000 acres, 200 gallons, or bottom line here, around $800 savings here that way. Again, nothing more than just management out there in the field. So summing up on this, what are the possibilities? And I won't go all the way through this slide, but some of these are going to be appropriate, others perhaps not for folks. But savings, depending on kind of where you're at in the scheme of things and what you decide to do, can be significant. Over a 1,000-acre operation, somewhere $9,000 to $13,000 would be kind of ballpark numbers is what we're after here. And many of these, with little or no additional out-of-pocket costs here that way. Okay, let's go over to forage operations, and there's some interesting fuel savings potential here in forage harvesting too. One of the bigger issues here is the cutter head in forage harvesting. When you look at the total amount of energy that forage harvester uses out there, it kind of depends on what else is on the machine, but 40 to 50% is not uncommon for what percent of energy or what percent of fuel is being used to cut and harvest that forage. And so making sure that you keep those knife surfaces sharp, keep them in close proximity with that stationary shear bar, very important. Just when we talk about close proximity, just a difference of a hundredth of an inch or 1/10,000th of an inch, if you will, can add some significant fuel use there, somewhere in the neighborhood of a half gallon to 3.5 gallons. So you want to make sure that you're keeping that sharp up the speed that way. Another thing, check and see, what's that theoretical length of cut that you need on that forage. Now, you obviously need a certain minimum out there, probably for packing, that type of thing, and the ensiling process, but certainly, don't go any shorter than need be out there. Longer theoretical lengths of cut, there's less cuts and a little more energy saved. Same type of thing on a blower, and we show a stationary blower here, but the same would be true on board on a forage harvester. But clearance between the impeller blades and the housing here, again, I would encourage folks to check that owner-operator's manual. The old-timers in this business always used to talk about that it seemed like you want enough clearance to move a nickel but not move a dime. And so I use that example just to show you that those clearances are pretty important, and just some small differences can make some real horsepower differences here in terms of what it takes to drive and cut and blow that crop that way. Let's take a look at savings potential again on that cutter head on a forage harvester. We're going to assume 1.5 gallon of fuel per acre used with a cutter head, and we'll say that 50% of that 1.5 gallon is being used, 1.5 gallon total for the forage harvester, but 50% of that's being used on the cutter head. Dull and misadjusted knives here can actually double the amount of that cutting energy that we talked about and add another 3/4 gallon of fuel per acre. Now, $4 a gallon, that's about $3 an acre, or over 100 acres, $300, or 1,000 acres, $3,000. So it can be pretty significant out there in terms of making sure that you've got that forage cutter head adjusted. Another word on forages, take advantage of a little solar drying, such as on a more conditioner operation, we want to leave maybe about as wide a swath as we dare out here, or we can adjust that more too, depending on weather conditions and such, to get a little more, a little faster drying out there, take a little more advantage of some free drying that way. And again, there's some excellent extension bulletins out there in terms of forage equipment management and energy management on this, but another thing to think about that way. Okay, I'm going to get a little closer to the wrap-up here, but one thing, and I'm going to go off the script just a little bit here on farm machinery, but one thing, if you're trying to save energy out there, I always think it's a little bit like trying to save money, save up some money, or maybe lose weight. A good first step is, you know, where's that energy going, or, you know, how much am I spending for energy, or, you know, how am I saving my money, you know, how many calories a day am I eating? Same type of concept here that way. But we use this bulletin kind of locally here for tracking energy use on the farm, and other states may have something quite similar here, so I'm not necessarily just plugging this one, but we've got linked with that. We encourage people to keep track as their fuel and electric bills come in. Keep track of those, and there's actually a downloadable Excel spreadsheet that's available kind of through the bulletin here, and it's noted on the handout notes here too, if you want another reference. But this is just what that spreadsheet might look like. Again, you know, filling in, say, you know, what the electric bill was for last month. Maybe we paid $500 in April, and we purchased 4,780 kilowatt hours. The spreadsheet automatically calculates that cost per kilowatt hour. A lot of people just have a rough idea of that, it seems like. And then it ends up with a running annual total here, too. Same type of thing can be used. There's entry points for diesel, gasoline, and a little further down, I've shown the slide, propane, natural gas, that type of thing. So, again, you know, how much are you using as you make some changes out there? You know, what's the potential for savings? And this can help you see if you're making a difference, I think, out there. Okay, to wrap up, I'll let you guys read through the bullet points here. But, again, you know, energy costs on a percent basis are maybe not all that high a percentage cost to the crop inputs out there. I'll grant that part. But they're probably the most easily managed out there. You know, it may be more difficult to manage the cash rent situation, or maybe more difficult to manage your total machinery depreciation costs, and even some of your seed and fertilizer prices. You know, you do the best job you can. Some of these things on energy are just kind of low-hanging fruit and some of the quickest, fastest ways to make changes out there. So that would be some things that I think would help people hopefully move people in the right direction. I'm going to wind up with just this slide, and I'll leave it up here for a minute maybe, but and then turn it over to Scott. But there's other resources out there, and certainly I would encourage you to first check locally on your local extension site, you know, what you've got available locally. In Iowa, we use this particular site, and we're developing bulletins that hopefully have some pertinence here for things going on in the state of Iowa, and perhaps for some other things around here. So I would encourage you to check it out if you haven't been there and would like to do it. Nationally, the eExtension site has got good sets of materials up there. If you go to that site and drill down under energy, and then farm energy as opposed to home energy, and then finally energy efficiency and conservation, there's a number of good bulletins, fact sheets, helps there. And Natural Resources Conservation Service has got an energy calculator. I know some of you may be quite aware of that, but again, kind of a first cut at looking at some things there. So there's other tools across the web. You're probably going to see some of these again mentioned in other webinars. But with that, Scott, I think I'm wrapping up here. So I'm going to turn it back over to you, see if we've got some questions, comments, rebuttal. I know there's people out there in the audience that probably have a little higher knowledge base than me on individually on some of these things too. So, thank you.
All right. Well, thanks, Mark. I just a couple things I'll throw out here, kind of add to what Mark has said. timers for block heaters that typically you can use, like a pool timer or that type of timer. They cost $20 to $40. So if you're getting $100 savings a year, it's a no-brainer as far as doing it. And most tractors will heat up in a couple hours. The other thing I was going to add is on windrow size with choppers. If you can make the windrow up toward the capacity of the chopper, you end up saving energy because it's going to use less energy to rake it into a windrow or merge it into a windrow of the appropriate size for the equipment you have. Plus, you're going to, you know, that expensive operation, especially if you're custom, having somebody custom chop, you've got to reduce that cost. The other thing I was going to add on nitrogen or fertilizer, there's been a lot of work lately on cover crops, legume cover crops, for supplying nitrogen. I know there's we have a publication here that's on using clover in winter wheat, so that once the wheat comes off, the clover takes off and supplies you some nitrogen for the next year. So there's just a couple of thoughts. I did, while we were having the meeting, I remembered a publication that we have on our site on strip till, and I uploaded that to the handout section. So if anybody wants that, it's on strip tillage, a conservation option for Wisconsin farmers. But in there, it actually has some financial data and yield data. And yes, in some cases, with no-till, yields are a little lower, or even with strip-till sometimes if you're doing continuous corn, but soybean corn, strip-till is about even with the chisel plow or conventional type. But the payback, at least here in Wisconsin, is about $23 an acre increased or reduced cost of production. We'll add that and open it up to any questions. And you have to unmute your phones, I think. I don't think I can do them here. Do we have any questions?
Scott?
Yeah.
This is Diane. I'm definitely not an expert in this, but just while you guys were talking, I've gone and looked at some things. Are you going to put the archives of these webinars on the eExtension website, too?
Yep, eventually we're going to get them up there.
Okay, that sounds great. And then for Mark, I took a quick look at your farm energy publications, and they look great. But one of the things is none of them do, you know, you brought up the energy implications of the particularly the nitrogen applications, and that doesn't show up on any of the ones I saw. Are you thinking of adding that to any of them?
Well, there is on that website. There should be one on nitrogen fertilizer that gets into that manufacturing energy type thing. And again, educationally, one of the big things that we wanted to do is get people familiar with, you know, they think about how much energy is being used in fertilizer and pesticides, and that's important. But we want to get across the nitrogen thing. So there is a piece that talks about some of that manufacturing energy and kind of fuel savings, but in terms of some of the distribution type stuff, I'll admit I kind of spun off a little bit on that, and that's not on the website right now, but we might take another look at that. I appreciate the comment, Diane.
Is that piece on your ISU website?
Well, I think so, but I'll okay. I'm going to double check on that, and I'll try and shoot you an email, Diane, on that. So
thank you. I'm sure it's there, and I just didn't notice it in 12 seconds of looking.
Yeah, I mean, the one thing on crop rotation, if you can put a legume crop in the rotation like an alfalfa, you know, you can basically almost apply the whole nitrogen requirement for corn the year after. The issue there is if you don't have a market for the forage, then that affects what you can plant. So sometimes a legume cover crop may be able to help you doing that. Any other questions? Well, if people find think of some things afterwards, you can email Mark. Mark, do you have your email up there anywhere?
You know, I don't see it on the slide, but I'll give it verbally right now, and I'm pretty easy to find. But H is in Harold, M is in Mark, and then my last name, H-A-N-N-A. And then it's at iastate.edu, like you see the extension down there on the website and stuff. But hmhanna@iastate.edu. Happy to hear questions, comments. Mark, I wish you would have talked about this, or feedback's fine too, so thanks.